Be having a conversation today. We're going to have some remarks as well as a armchair conversation about value-based procurement as a tool for economic growth. Why do we want to have a conversation about something that sounds kind of obscure? It's not something that gets the heart beat pumping faster necessarily. We've also done other things on other scintillating topics like tax systems here of late. I think what you'll realize, for those of you who have braved the rain, is that actually procurement touches a vast amount of decisions all over the world, not just in the United States, but something like 25% of the gross national product of many developing countries, resources flow through sort of a variety of procurement decisions in developing countries. There's all sort. The stakes are actually quite high, and the numbers are quite large. This is a time of great ferment and change in the developing world, and it touches on the issue of procurement in a number of different ways. There's been an increasing amount of growth in middle-income countries. There's been an increasing amount of urbanization. There's been increasing demand by a growing middle class for a higher quality of governance and public administration. They want higher quality services. There's also this touches on issues of global trade, things like the Trans-Pacific Partnership and other trade agreements. It has all sorts of implications. There's also huge demands for energy and infrastructure. And so as a result of that, with all these have all sorts of procurement decisions. And it's not just at the national government, but it's at the subnational government. There have been a series of activities that have been going on to respond to that, to this change in ferment. For example, our friends at USTDA have a value-based procurement program that you're going to learn about, and they will tell you that the World Bank followed them and that there is a new policy that's about to be promulgated by the World Bank looking at moving away from just a low-bid-only a form of procurement to a toolkit approach. And so I think we'll learn a little bit about that. I think the point, and one of the reasons I wanted to host this conversation, it builds on some of the work that we were doing supported by GE a couple years ago, looking at procurement as part of the development agenda, is that there are millions of people who touch procurement decisions in the developing world. If we want them to be trained to another level of sophistication or capacity or capability, this is going to be a massive, massive undertaking that people are not yet fully getting their collective brains around in terms of what it's going to actually take. One thing will be to promulgate the policy. I think there'll be quite another thing to actually find the resources and actually train potentially millions of people over a 10 or 20 year period. So I think we'll hear a lot about this in the conversation. But I'm going to turn over the floor to my friend Lee Zack, who's been here many times. I think she runs one of the most interesting agencies in government, and we're really fortunate to have her. I think she's one of the most effective public administrators in the Obama administration, and so we're really lucky that she's taken time out of her schedule, and then we'll have an armchair discussion. Lee Zack from TDA, please come on up. Okay, good. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dan, for that kind introduction. And I want to thank CSIS for having us all here today for this discussion. Before I begin, I really do want to thank our panelists for coming here today to talk about this topic. In particular, I'd have to thank Andrea Lupo, who is with the U.S. Trade and Development Agency, and Dan Gordon, who helped to start the Global Procurement Initiative that Dan mentioned this morning. And I also want to thank Marianne Ring from GE, because they have been such a great advocate for this particular topic. Why is this topic of such great interest now? And I want to give you a little bit of a history. I think that's part of what the panel is going to talk about today. But I'd like to give you a little bit of the history of how USTDA got involved in this topic. As many of you know, USTDA is an independent federal government agency that focuses on developing infrastructure in developing and middle-income countries. So we focus in particular on energy, transportation, and telecommunications. And we do that by looking at the beginning of projects and also trying to bring together the right partners. In particular, bringing U.S. to these projects, U.S. businesses, for both goods and services. But one of the things we do is we work on early project planning. And what we have heard with respect to the development of infrastructure is that this early project planning stage is one of the most important stages for leveraging the private sector, for leveraging their interest in projects, as well as leveraging their funding in these projects. As we have been doing this early project planning, one of the things that USTDA has focused on is the importance not only of planning it, but have you set forth the right terms of reference, and have you set forth the right way for people to then procure whatever it is that's planned? Because that is the next step in the process, and equally important. So as we have put together our feasibility studies, as we've been doing that planning, we have been moving into this next stage and looking at how is it then subsequently procured. But USTDA prides itself on listening to its stakeholders. And in the process of meeting with our stakeholders on these issues, talking to our host country partners, one of the things that they have begun to discover is that for years now, they've been building infrastructure, but in many cases, they're not getting what they paid for. Or you might say they got what they paid for. And as a result, their infrastructure is not where they want it to be. It may be deteriorating faster than they anticipated. So there's significant experience with certain types of procurement, low cost, and also now seeing what the results of that are. So we've had our host country partners come to us saying, is there a way that you can help us with this? They have a problem. They want adequate infrastructure for the future. What can you do to help us? At the same time, I was meeting with a group of ambassadors from a regional group and talking about how the U.S. may be able to get more involved in their activities. And their response to me was, well, you know, U.S. companies aren't going to win bids. And I'm like, what do you mean they're not going to win? And they're like, well, it's all about cost. And we said, no, actually, it's not all about cost. One of the things that we should really be looking at is cost over time. What is the long-term value? And you're going to hear more about this in detail during the panel discussion today. But one of the things that is important is to be able to level the playing field, to be able to allow for U.S. businesses to bid, because this is one of the things that they really focus on, is the value over time. What it's going to cost with respect to maintenance, how long is it going to last. So as a result of listening to our stakeholders, we decided to look into this further. And we thought that one of the things that was extremely important was to be able to provide education in this area to our stakeholders. But we also recognize the importance of having the right partners. And that's what USTDA does, is we develop partnerships. So we developed a partnership with GW Law School, known experts in this area. Dan Gordon was principally involved in this, and we thank him for his expertise and his advice as we developed this. But we also reached out, and Dan alluded to it, we also reached out to the development banks because a lot of the funding is being provided by them. And we knew that this was an issue that they had begun to face, but we wanted to be sure that we were working in lockstep with our potential financiers. So as 2 years ago, as we put this initiative together, we brought together GW Law School and as a partner, and all of the multilateral development banks agreed to be collaborators with us. And I think one of the things you will hear during the course of the panel today is how they have subsequently been participating in our activities. Andrea will talk more in detail about the activities, but basically the bottom line of our global procurement initiative is what we're trying to do is to provide access, support, and opportunity. Access, one of the things we're doing is providing access for local procurement officials to top-notch training. So we're providing in-country training by experts from GW Law School, also sometimes experts in a particular industry as well in country. Opportunity for those experts subsequently to come to the United States, and frankly in the future to other countries, and I'll explain that in a minute, but come to the United States and meet with U.S. officials who are doing procurement. But that could be on the federal level, it could be on the county level, and state level. And again, depending on the partner, it depends which one they're better matched with. So not only is this about training, but they're talking with their peers in the U.S. One of the things we're about to do, and I'm very excited about, and you'll see from the papers that you have on your chair, which describe some of our partners, mm-hmm. One of our first partners was Botswana. And they have been very active, and basically they came to us because of a potentially failed procurement, and as a result, we provided this training. They now are going to be our ambassadors to other countries in Africa to basically say, this is what we've learned, this is how we're going to make changes, and now we're going to come and talk to you. So it's more of a peer-to-peer discussion. And then ultimately, with respect to support, as we all know, we can go to training one day, and as many of you probably remember from communications training and other things, you're going to remember about one-third of what people said. So you need to have that reinforcement. Hmm. So as a result, what we're doing is we're providing advisors in-country for the coming year to stay with those procurement officials, to look at their regulatory environments, to help them with the procurements. So we want to make sure what was trained, they have the ability to have someone by their side as they move forward to implement it. So as a result of this, we've had tremendous feedback, and frankly, we've been able to see success. Botswana that I mentioned is an example where after the training was done, they began to implement part of what we were talking about. And as a result, what we heard from U.S. businesses was that they now had opportunities they hadn't had before, that the procurements were set up in such a way they felt it made sense for them to be bid. And more importantly, they were shortlisted for the first time in a long time because of the requirements were set up for best value. So from what we're doing, we're seeing the ability to be able to bring more U.S. companies once we've leveled the playing field in the procurement arena. And that's one of the reasons why it is so important and so valuable. It's to level that playing field. Dan mentioned the World Bank. One of the things that we're seeing is the fact that, again, the multilaterals are very interested in this area. And they've actually been sending some of their representatives to our training. And we've had a good opportunity to talk with them about what it is that they're doing. As many of you know, they're also in the process of changing some of their systems and provide sort of a variety of ways to do procurement. So we're delighted that the World Bank has asked us if we'd be willing to partner with them through an MOU. And we're in the process of working with them to finalize that MOU to provide for a partnership between USTDA and the World Bank on procurement, and in particular, this issue focused around best value. So I'm very excited today about this topic, and I want to thank you for coming through the rain to talk about this. I look forward to the panel discussion because I think each one of the panelists has something very valuable to offer from different perspectives, but I also very much look forward to a discussion with all of you about how you see some of these issues and what it is that we can do to help you, whether it's representing a host country, whether it's providing access by U.S. companies to some of these procurements. So I look forward to further discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Lee. Okay, armchair participants, please come on up. I'm going to have you sit here, Dan, and I'll have Andrea sit here, and I'll have Marianne sit. Why don't you sit there and, yeah. Okay. Good. Okay, so this is a as I think we've established, this is actually a bigger deal than when you first say, okay, why do we care about procurement? Why should we care about this? I suspect this is an audience that already understands that this is quite important, but I'm hoping we've got several experts from several different perspectives that are gonna take us through the issues as well as talking about the conversation about a procurement more broadly. So we've got really some very thoughtful people. We have Mr. Dan Gordon, who's a senior advisor to the Government Procurement Law Program at George Washington University. He had a past life. He was the administrator for federal procurement policy, which is like being the czar, the procurement czar of the federal government. It's actually quite an important post in the U.S. government on issues of procurement. Then we have Andrea Lupo, who's the director for global programs at USTDA, and she's responsible for global initiatives and programs for the agency, including the newly launched GPI that Lee Zach was talking about. And then we also have my friend Marianne Ring. Thanks for being here. And she's the company-wide liaison for development finance institutions, and so she has an up-close and personal experience with procurement issues on a daily basis, working with institutions like the World Bank and the Inter-American Development Bank and others, and so, as well as partner governments all over the world. So, Dan, we were talking beforehand about that there's a lot of ferment going on in the procurement sector. Tell us a little bit about that.
With great pleasure, Dan. I do want to thank you for hosting this event. I want to thank USTDA for letting me participate. For those of you that don't know, the George Washington University Law School, GW, has had for more than 50 years a government procurement law program. It's quite astonishing that it's existed for
it's
so
astonishing.
Long. I wasn't there at the beginning, just for the record. But it is...
started as a child prodigy.
Exactly. Right. In kindergarten, there I was. Exactly. I said, Mommy, when I grow up, I want to do procurement. I was the only one. GW has been teaching government procurement law for more than 50 years. It is the only place in North America where you can actually get a degree in procurement law, and I'll be happy to take your application during the break. We were pleased to have this partnership with USTDA. I think it's been a very good fit. We teach procurement law both in the United States and around the world. My colleague Chris Eukins and I helped craft a course, golly, more than 10 years ago when I was still at GAO, teaching as an adjunct to GW, in international and comparative public procurement law. So we have an international perspective that fits very well with what USTDA is doing. In terms of the point you make, Dan, which is very important, why now? Why is procurement such a hot topic now? I think there's more recognition today than ever before about procurement in both a positive and a negative sense. The positive sense that Lee alluded to is that procurement can help countries develop. If they want to improve their infrastructure, if they want to improve their education system, if they want to improve their hospital system, procurement is very important. But also in a negative sense, there's a recognition that procurement is a major, major door to corruption. And corruption is, as Jim Wolfensohn at the World Bank said many years ago, a cancer in terms of the developing world, but not only the developing world. We've seen procurement corruption in every country, including our own. My colleagues at GW Law and I have done a lot of training around the world, but we recognize that the need for procurement training feels endless sometimes. The numbers that you alluded to are spectacular, and there's just too many people to train and too much training to do.
That's great. Job security.
Well, there is that. That said, not only have I been honored to work with USTDA in training in Botswana that Lee alluded to, but also Vietnam, the Philippines. My colleagues helped with the USTDA program in Romania a few months ago. We're about to go to Ethiopia in 10 days to do training in Addis. But we've also, my colleagues at GW Law and I, have worked with the World Trade Organization. I was in Geneva, for example, 10 days ago doing training. We've worked with the World Bank, both in South Asia and in North Africa and elsewhere. I helped in a U.S. Department of Commerce training in Southeast Asia a few months ago. There is a lot of training taking place, but there's a lot more to do. I often say in the training that one of the challenges is that in every country, this is true in the United States, it's true in India, it's true in Peru, in every country, there's a three-way tug going on procurement. On the one hand, you have those people that are saying procurement needs to move faster. You need to be more flexible. You need to have fewer rules. You need to focus on quality. Don't just focus on low price. There's that tug. But there's a counter tug of the people that are saying, what about corruption? We need transparency. We need to have audits. We need to have more rules. That tug is going on in every country. It goes on in the halls of Congress right now, I promise you. When they talk about defense acquisition reform, that fight is going on. And a third fight, a third tug, is represented by those people who say, we need to spend the money, because it's our money, on domestic companies, and especially our domestic small businesses, SMEs as they're called outside the United States. Those three tugs are taking place in every system. Well, people laugh about it, you see.
I know.
But the fact
is, it's
no
laughing matter.
Exactly. You can't ignore any one of them. You can't tell Senator McCaskill, oh, Senator McCaskill, we're not worried about transparency and procurement. Sorry. But you can't tell Senator McCain, to use American examples, sir, we don't care about it. We don't care about quality and efficiency and speed. Can't do it. And you can't tell the Small Business Committee in the House or the Senate, we're not worried about U.S. small businesses. You need to meet all of their, you need to at least listen to all their demands. So where does that take us in terms of the trends that are out there? A couple of trends that I'll say, and then I'll stop because I don't want to talk too long. One is there is a growing recognition that a complaint mechanism, an effective procurement complaint mechanism, is critically important. You hear this at the World Bank. You hear this in countries around the world. It's very tough. It gives you accountability, but lets you feel more comfortable when you are focusing on quality and not just low price. Secondly, when you are looking at price, there's a growing recognition that price is much more than just the ticket price. You've got to think about life cycle cost. You've got to think about the total cost of ownership. How you do that is not so easy. I can tell you our Department of Defense struggles to figure out life cycle cost for weapon systems. It is not easy when you're talking to government officials in the Philippines or in Brazil to get them to say, well, how am I going to figure out how much the tractor is going to cost over 5 years? And then, and here I'll stop, there's the issue of what we procurement folks call non-price factors. How do you take into account quality? How do you take into account past performance of companies? Figuring out those non-price factors, using them in a way that's transparent so that bidders know what the rules are. They know how you're going to pick the winner. Do you use a scoring system? And is the scoring system for those non-price factors, how transparent is that going to be? Those are major challenges. But what we hear in the trainings around the world is enormous interest in learning how to do those things. We hear frustration with dealing with low cost only and a thirst, frankly, to learn how to take into account a more sophisticated price analysis and how to take into account those non-price factors. Let me stop there to give our colleagues a chance
Thank
to talk.
You very
Thank
much.
You very much.
Andrea, you have, I think, probably one of the most interesting jobs at TDA.
Well, thank you. I like it. Lee did a great job in terms of explaining the background of how it is we became involved in the procurement field. And Dan did a great job going over all of the challenges we face being involved in this very challenging area, which of course explains why we partnered with George Washington University in the first place. But I wanted just to talk to you a little bit more about how we came about the initiative in terms of structuring the initiative. We knew at TDA, based upon our experience from our early project planning, that we had to come at this issue in a very unique way. We had to do this differently than we've done any other initiative in our history, mainly because of the challenges and the sensitivities around procurement. We knew that we needed the right partners in place. We knew that we needed to create an environment in a non-threatening way to be able to teach about how to use these best practices on how to obtain value for money and how to get the best value for public funds. And we had to do it in a way that we could share freely about the risk involved, as Dan's already touched on with the corruption, how to manage corruption, be transparent, and of course open up these markets for competition. And so we did so knowing that this couldn't be an initiative where it appeared that the U.S. government was wagging a finger, showing governments how to do procurement. That was not going to be successful, but we wanted to create an initiative with all of the partners that Lee mentioned, with the multilateral development banks, with George Washington, academics who are globally recognized in this field, to share best practices from around the world on how they can actually obtain the best value. Because it's not that they lack the desire, as Lee mentioned, they just don't know how to do it. And so we wanted to create an initiative that could get at this very issue on how to obtain value. And so after partnering with George Washington University and partnering with, collaborating with the multilateral development banks, we also know that when it comes down to it, this is all about individual sectors. The tenders are involved are in individual sectors. So we hired technical specialists in energy, transportation, public works, IT, to help address how do you look at life cycle cost, and how do you do a life cycle cost analysis of a power plant? How do you do a life cycle cost analysis of an airport? Changing their mindset, looking at how you develop infrastructure projects. You can't plan them on a 5-year timeline. You need to build infrastructure on a 30 to 50 year timeline. And how do you do that? How do you manage your cost and maintain your investment so that you can truly build the economic growth that these countries are seeking? And so with that, after we organized ourselves and created and built what we feel is the perfect structure to kind of take this initiative on, we of course went out to see what type of interest we would have in the emerging market economy, or with our emerging economies, and we were overwhelmed with our initial response. We had 19 countries submit applications to be a part of the GPI when we initially launched in August of 2013. We had to develop stringent criteria, of course, because we don't want to invest all of this time and money into countries that aren't really committed to obtaining best value. They're not committed to managing corruption or maintaining transparent structures, and they're not committed to competition. So we actually developed very stringent criteria to look at these countries in a very unique way to see, are they truly committed? Are they committed to open and fair competition? And are they committed to the professionalization of their procurement workforce? Because none of this can happen without sufficient training to carry these value-based procurement mechanisms out. And so we, of course, as Lee said, targeted Botswana and Vietnam because they were the first applicants that met all of the criteria. Since then, we have added Romania, the Philippines, and we will be in Ethiopia in the next 10 days to bring them on board. We have 10 new countries that have already begun working with us to complete our due diligence process to become members of the GPI. And I do want to share with you just a few examples of the results that we've seen from some of our, I'll actually just focus on Botswana because since they were first, they're further along in the program. But as Lee mentioned, they're already starting to implement what they've learned in the GPI. In fact, their Ministry of Transport and Communications, they came back to us and said that they're already trying to practice best value and utilize life cycle cost analysis in the procurement of vehicles, photocopying machines, road construction, and they're looking to establish an exchange program with the Texas Department of Transportation, which we were very proud because that is a relationship that we introduced them to through one of their programs here. Our orientation visit, we brought them here, and the city of Austin showed them a great time, fed them lots of barbecue, and they fell in love.
That always works.
They fell in love with some of the procurement mechanisms that they learned about through the state of Texas, and they're looking to partner with them to help implement some of those models. Also, the Public Procurement and Asset Disposal Board, and that is the agency that we partnered with in Botswana. They are the procurement authority in Botswana. They've already started implementing training programs at the various procuring entities. They're already looking at how to, based upon Dan's great training, how to implement non-price factors in the evaluation of their bids. They're looking and they're training multiple procuring entities at the same time. And of course, we've also provided two advisors to their Ministry of Mining, Energy, and Water Resources that are working with them on creating the transparent structures that they need to report out on these various tenders, and an actual advisor helping them develop 14 tenders within the next 12 months that will be going out to bid utilizing what they've learned. In addition, as an offset, we talked about the professionalization. we talk about the sustainability of what we're leaving behind. We invited not only just the multilateral development banks to come to our trainings in country, we actually invited the local universities in Botswana to come in. And we facilitate those relationships because we realize they need to have some sort of academic institution or institution to train this curriculum after we leave. And so the University of Botswana came back to us very enthusiastic after we finished our first round of training. And they said, we are going to establish a curriculum on procurement here at the University of Botswana. They sent over a huge curriculum to our dear friend Dan Gordon and myself, and are seeking just help trying to establish their own curriculum. But what we're seeing is positive change. They're, as Lee already mentioned, they're going to be training in Ethiopia as our ambassadors when we're there in the next 10 days, sharing their experiences working under the GPI. So we're really pleased. We're seeing this type of change from Botswana, but we're also seeing change in Vietnam, and we're seeing changes coming from Romania and the Philippines, all in a positive direction. So I have to say thank you to our partners for hanging with us and giving us the guidance we need to make this so successful. And we really look forward to building this up because we are seeing great positive changes just in the first two. Imagine what we can do if we add 20 or 40 countries.
Thank you. Thank you. Aaron, thanks for being here. You, as GE, is one of the largest companies in the world. You work with clients all over the world, whether it's the World Bank, you work with host country governments all over the world. And so the issue of procurement is something that your company and many other global companies have to deal with on a daily basis. And so you understand the why this is an important topic, and we really appreciated GE encouraging us and supporting us to do some work on this a couple of years ago. And that's when the light bulb went off for me, because I knew a little bit about procurement, but from my time in grad school, I'd done some work for, with Steve Kelman, who'd had the procurement czar job before Dan had. So so tell us a little bit about GE's perspective on this issue, and sure. Thanks for being here.
Sure. First of all, thank you, Dan. Thanks to CSIS and TDA for including GE in this very important topic. And I look to the audience. How many of you get excited about government procurement?
Oh, me. me.
What I really think we need
I spend my weekends, yes.
No, but it just seems like it's such an underappreciated tool in the whole array of government, of foreign assistance, of economic development. And I wish someone would host a competition to come up with a jingle or a bumper sticker or a theme song so we could get some excitement around this.
We're a think tank and we're full of ideas, so I'll have to go I'll have a think on that and come back to you. But I actually think you're right about that. We're going to have to come up with some kind of a hook to want to make this
more exciting.
Yes.
Well, look, government procurement is exciting to GE. It is very important. When we look at our customer base around the world, a big segment of our customers are public entities. Whether it's public utilities that are building power plants to bring electricity to people who don't have it, ministries of health, their hospitals are buying medical equipment, government-owned railways buy our locomotives, and municipalities are upgrading their street lighting, bringing safety and energy efficiency to their citizens. All of this is extremely important, but it's often a very bumpy ride in a lot of the emerging markets. The process to get our customers the products and technologies and solutions that they want, there's a lot of room for improving that process. And we look forward to finding ways to increase the efficiency, the transparency, and even the sustainability of how all of this is done. We applaud TDA for your initiative on government procurement. It's very important. And we wish that other U.S. government agencies would get more excited about procurement and join forces here. You know, one thing that strikes me is that I just don't know how commonly known it is what impact bad procurement has on the resources of government budgets. And I would love to see an economic analysis, a case study of a single procurement that is canceled. You know, count up the person hours of everybody involved, the government officials, all the people they hire, the advisors, the consultants, the legal folks, then you count up the time of all the bidders, all the people in their organizations, it takes a lot of effort to put together a really good quality offer. And then you look at financial institutions, whoever's financing, look at all those people, their time, the products that they've put together, and what does that cost when it's canceled? So the startup, the start and stop of the buying cycle is a huge economic drain on public resources. And I just believe it would be handy to have a little economic formula that that you could highlight and say, look where your tax dollars are going down the drain if it's not an efficiently run procurement practice. So there are two key things that you guys have all hit on that are really important for us as a company. One is the life cycle cost analysis. Rather than just looking at the lowest cost of the offer, I'd like to flag one best practice that we seem to do well with in Mexico, the public utility called CFE. They've developed a very robust, very transparent set of criteria that all the bidders know way ahead of time. It's very detailed and very thoughtful, and they analyze the biggest part of operating power plant, which is fuel costs. So they give a very heavily weighted score for efficiency. The fuel consumption is just everyone knows how big of a factor that is. So they've gotten away from just looking, well, what's your bid for the capital expenditures up front. And we think it's probably the most transparent. In addition to being sound and thoughtful, it's very transparent, probably the most in Latin America. Another point is sustainability. I'll draw on another example from our company that's the healthcare sector. So for medical equipment, unfortunately, a lot of governments are looking at it as like a commodity. So what does it cost for your x-ray machine or your this or your that, rather than looking at the life cycle of operating that, all the consumables and other things like training that have to go into that. But they often don't buy service contracts, maintenance contracts, and the training, the upfront user training, but then additional, more sophisticated training. And so I think the WHO has estimated 50% of medical equipment that's either donated or sold to Africa is sitting inoperable. It's such a tragedy. So, sustainability is really important. If you're going to acquire the thing, make sure people know how to use it, the site is ready to receive it, and you have the ongoing budget to deal with service maintenance and consumables. So with that, for starters,
thank you.
Let's go.
So, okay, let me just put a couple questions. Thank you. Andrea, Dan, I was asking this earlier, just so the audience understands, how many federal government, just U.S. government, contracting officers are there in the U.S. government?
Well, in the U.S. government, on the federal level only, we have something like 36,000 contracting officers. We have more contracting staff, of course. But that gives you a sense of how big a task is. I mean, when I was the administrator, I would send emails out that were called notes from the administrator once a month that were meant to go to all of the contracting officers. That's a lot of people to try to reach.
And Andrew, we were talking about what it takes. If you want to be certified, you said there were three levels.
Right, in the U.S. system.
Just in the U.S. system. Just to get a sense of this. How many hours just to be level one?
40 hours every 2 years.
To be level one?
Just to be level one.
And at level two and three, same?
No, it goes up. As you go up, each level you go up, the number of hours you have to maintain your training goes up as well. To get to level three, you have to have completed at least 120 hours of training. And for a contracting officer, it's even higher, mainly because the training goes up as their warrant goes up, in terms of how much money they can control.
They're entrusted with, in terms of what their credit card is, if I can put it that way, or their debit card.
Right.
Just in terms of, so if I'm in Botswana, and when I grow up, I want to be a procurement officer, how do I become a procurement officer in one of your countries?
Right now, that's one of the issues, is that it's not treated as a professional career track. So when you go to a university, there's not any courses that you take to become a procurement officer. We want to fix that. We want to create a career path for government procurement officials in these countries, because ultimately they need a career path in order to entice them into the industry. They also need increases in pay. So a lot of these countries, you have to realize the majority of these decisions are being made by people who only make $200 a month. And so, of course,
who are these folks?
I mean, these are the procurement officials, and one of the problems that we face is that if I'm a procurement official only making $200 a month, I'm not going to risk my safety and of my family or my career. So I make the easiest choice, and that choice is by low cost. If I pick the lowest price, I won't get charged with corruption, and I won't have to worry about someone coming back and threatening my job, or worse, threatening to put me in jail. It's a real problem. So it's all about changing the mindset, creating a career path, and allowing these folks to obtain and empowering them to be able to use these higher value mechanisms and empowering them to do what's better for the country and for their own procuring entity.
Marianne, could you just talk a little bit, just briefly, about how this touches on, there's oftentimes in trade agreements discussions about this issue of procurement in terms of how, when we negotiate, say, a trade agreement with, either it's when we talk about TPP or TTIP, one of the sensitive issues is around procurement. How procurement fits into, just in general, just in simple terms, how when we think about these issues. My sense is it's about whether the U.S. is treated as a local participant in an economy is generally sort of the main point of these when we talk about trade.
Sorry that I am not one of the trade gurus in GE, but I can give you their phone number. But I can say that this thing about the local content requirement.
And I want to come back to that, exactly.
That is a big topic, and it's troubling.
I've been making a list of things, like what are the things that matter, and what are the jingles that, I've got like five things that we're going to use as like the jingle things. One is local sourcing, I want to come back to. But on this issue of trade.
In the trade agreements, for the last 20 years, every free trade agreement the United States has signed, every free trade agreement the United States has signed has a government procurement chapter to it. That government procurement chapter sets the minimum standards for the procurement system, right? So they have to, for example, they have to have a complaint mechanism, right? They have to give bidders at least X days to submit their bids. Those minimum standards are consistent with the international norm. For example, the World Trade Organization's Agreement on Government Procurement, or the UN Commission on International Trade Law, UNCITRAL's Model Procurement Law. That's one. Two, the trade agreements typically open up markets because they're trade agreements, so that you agree that you're going to treat the partner countries' companies and products just the way you treat domestic companies and products for the procurements that are within the scope of the agreement.
That's it. Thank you. So let me come back to Marianne's. How do we get people to care about this? And these will be we're going to go to the creatives on Madison Avenue or elsewhere to come up with the jingle. But I think one is this issue of local sourcing. So if you've heard of the issue of local sourcing and local procurement, that there's been in the last 10 years, this has been sort of an increasing, this is shooting up as an issue. You're seeing this. If you're in the energy business or the mining business, you're seeing that. That's sort of one thing that I'm seeing out there that touches on this issue of procurement. Another one, these are really, really big numbers. These are really big numbers in terms of the amounts of money that are decided and business that's decided, percentages, very significant percentages of GNP. I think the other thing is this issue of government, the increasing demands for quality government services, because of either the emerging middle class. Because I also think governments are being put at risk. They're actually, if people are being voted out of government if they're not delivering on things like street lights or whether they're paving the roads correctly or they're getting power. These sorts of things have ballot box consequences. I think the other thing is just sort of the ongoing understanding and sensitization and appreciation of corruption as an issue as something that there's been an increased focus on the issue of procurement as sort of a node of I'm trying to understand getting around that. And I think the other is around global competition, and I think there's a sub-theme, which is China, where that is certainly, I think, has driven a lot of sort of the energy around these issues. I think there are other things as well, but I don't think, but when I listen to this conversation, those are the things that kind of come out in terms of things that I say, what is driving the sort of the robustness of the procurement conversation when I'm out there talking to policymakers or I'm talking to multilateral development banks or companies. These are sort of the things that seem to that are pinging on my radar screen on this issue. But I got a couple additional more specific questions, but I wanted to put those on the table. So on this issue of buy local, can you all just kind of respond to this? What is your reaction when there's a significant amount of law, there are an increasing number of laws in developing countries on this issue of local sourcing. Maybe I could just start with you, Dan, if this comes across.
I mentioned as one of the three tugs that I talked about. One of those tugs is this is our taxpayers' money. It should go to our companies, especially our SMEs, our small businesses. That's true in every country. I don't know that you're right when you say it's an increasing trend. The United States Buy American Act is from the 1930s. That's not a new trend.
Very new.
Right. When we were young.
Right, when we were young, yes.
But it is a tug, that's true. Let me give you a concrete example. When I did the training for Southeast Asian governments in Singapore a few months ago, we did a little survey, an anonymous survey. They didn't have to disclose who was answering. There were about eight countries, government representatives in the room, and we said to them, in the tug between those who want more flexibility, focus on quality, and those who want to have more transparency, guess low price, where are you? The vast majority said, we need more flexibility. We need more focus on quality. Very interesting. But then I said to them, where are you on domestic preferences? Do you think you need more domestic preferences or fewer domestic preferences? Much to my surprise, that audience split right down the middle. Mm. About half of them said we have too many domestic preferences, but about half of them said we don't have enough. So I do think that is a genuine tug in every country, by the way, including in our good House of Representatives here in Washington.
Andrea.
Absolutely, we see this all the time in the GPI. Dan is very familiar with it. It comes up all the time as we're teaching. But we also teach the best practices of competition. A lot of these markets, they want innovative solutions, yet they are pulled and torn between having the local companies provide it, which may or may not have the most innovative solutions. And so opening up to competition, what that does, a lot of them, we have to allay their fears on competition because a lot of them say, oh no, the local companies just can't compete and they're gonna lose. And I was like, well, think about this. As you increase competition, as you see more and more high quality goods coming into your market, it creates more opportunities for these companies to partner with your local companies, helping them transfer that knowledge to your local companies. It also, as you create more competition, you get higher quality and it drives the prices down, the more competitors you have in your market. So we teach them all of the best practices, the pros and cons of how to balance those tugs, as Dan's already described, and how we can deal with that. And of course, the GPI is promoting competition because we want to open markets to greater competition, higher quality, greater innovation, and how do we do that? And they can see the benefit. And as you said, as Dan already said, the majority of them always want better quality because they feel like they're not getting it in with what they have right now. In Botswana, while we were there, there were 16-hour a day brownouts because the tender that Lee alluded to actually had to deal with their local power plant. And it went horribly wrong for a number of reasons. But of course, there are things that they could have done better in the procurement, things that the contractor could have done. But they want to avoid these.
Was it an American company?
No.
It was not.
Okay, I was hoping that was the case.
It was not. But again, and I tell you, they would probably come back and give you a huge number in terms of how it's impacted their country as a whole, because I will tell you, we were almost 2 hours late to our meeting with the Ministry of Transportation because the power was out and none of the traffic lights worked. So, I mean, in terms of how this affects their day-to-day operation, it's huge, and it's on the front of papers every day. And so this is something that really committed their government to making sure that they don't make these mistakes again, that they get the best quality, because it ultimately does affect the daily lives of everyday people.
Can I tell a quick anecdote?
Yes.
When we were in Botswana, I landed in Gaborone Airport and was in a taxi cab going to the hotel. And the taxi driver didn't know who I was. He says to me, that terminal at the airport is such a nuisance. You know, it's a new terminal, but they can't get the darn thing fixed. They awarded that thing a low price and the contractor isn't delivering. I'm thinking, I don't believe this. What is it, a paid political announcement for USTDA? I swear to God, it's a true story.
That's awesome. Okay, So not to challenge what you said, what I'm hearing is that especially in the developing world, there is definitely an increase in these requirements or preferences that are given for local production. So there are different versions of this.
I mean, I see it in the energy sector. Where I see it is in the energy sector.
Infrastructure sector, for sure. There are different versions. One is, we, the procuring agency, will only give an award to a company that's locally registered. Or it could be that a certain percentage of your product must be manufactured locally.
In Brazil.
Or it could be that we score you preferentially when you source different, you know, amounts of local content. So here's how it plays out. We pick and choose where we go to do business, right, based on the market demand, et cetera. So we look at the opportunities. Some small country that is not a priority country in the grand scheme of things for us as a company, they say in order to win the contract for a wind farm, you must manufacture your wind turbines in our country. And we look and say, what's the size of the market? How much additional business are we likely to get over the next 5 years?
And the country is 3 million people.
3 million people. Are we really going to set up a manufacturing facility? It just doesn't make sense. So we're going to walk, and you're going to be left with a smaller pool of competition, and your costs are going to be higher. So that's the reality. It's shrinking competition. Now, GE's fortunate because we're a huge company with a lot of capabilities, and we can, if we want to, say, okay, we're going to build a manufacturing facility from scratch, or we will help our suppliers do so that they can make enough to satisfy the content requirements. But I would say that largely we think it's market distorting and not in the best interest of the end user or the customer. But again, we localize all over the world. We're doing great, and we can. But a lot of companies are just not going to do it.
So let me pivot just slightly. I want to talk about the issue of, I want you to react to this comment that sometimes cheap can be expensive. So I want to talk about going with a low bid versus something like a life cycle cost. Explain can someone just talk about what does a life cycle cost mean? And if you go with a life cycle cost, what does that imply in terms of either, what does it mean for a procurement officer? Does that mean it's a higher level of engagement? And what does it mean for a company, like whether it's a GE, or does it mean it's a different, is it a different ball game for companies if they're being awarded contracts on a life cycle cost basis? What is that? Does it change the role of a company?
We could all talk about it, but why don't I defer to?
Sure. Well, I mean, life cycle cost is just as the name describes, you're looking at the total cost that you're going to incur over the life of that investment. So you're looking at not only the ticket price, your acquisition cost, you're looking at the cost to sustain that asset, which is everything from O&M, services, everything.
So what's O&M?
Operations and maintenance. Services, replacing parts, spare parts, things of that nature, everything to sustain that asset for however long I need it to be viable. And then you have to also minus out or think about your disposal cost of what you might have or salvage cost that you might have at the end of the life of a piece of equipment.
What would you buy on a life cycle cost basis?
So it doesn't make sense, for example, to use LCCA when you're buying office furniture. Life cycle cost analysis when you're buying office furniture or small procurements.
Or pens or something.
Pens or anything like that. However, what we see is that we have countries around the world that are building large pieces of infrastructure the same
like
way
like an airport.
Right.
Like a wind farm.
Building wind farms.
Power
building
plants.
Like a power plant.
Things of that nature without thinking of these outward costs, much like you wouldn't think about the outward cost of your table. And you're like, I'm fine with this table. These tables look great. This is just fine. I don't need to do an LCC, a life cycle cost analysis on these tables. However, if I'm going to purchase
I spend my weekend doing life. That's exactly. We were talking about this, how excited we are about procurement.
But it does matter if I am purchasing certain boilers or certain types of turbines for my power plant and the efficiency and how I'll be able to run those turbines and how it'll be able to handle peak load. All of these things have to play into, and this is why the engineers who actually design and work on these types of projects, they know these types of things. But here's the problem. We're not educating the people who are the public procurement officials on what it takes to maintain that asset. And the politicians and the people who are in power, they're only concerned about What can I get through the next 6 years?
Before I get elected.
Exactly.
I get reelected.
So you can't run an economy like that, and you can't build infrastructure like that. You have to think about, what am I going to do to maintain that asset for 30 to 50 years? Because if you're certainly using the MDBs for financing, you're going to be paying for it for the next 30 years. So you might as well make sure that it doesn't stop working in the middle and you still have to pay for it for another 15 years. And that's what we're seeing. And so the whole purpose of the GPI is to educate individuals on how to use LCCA appropriately. It doesn't have to be used in every procurement. Lease cost, technically acceptable, is perfectly fine for a lot of the smaller. But when you get into the larger complex infrastructure projects, you need to be able to build smart infrastructure. You need to be aware and educate the people who actually have to fund this for the next however many years on what it's going to take to maintain that asset. That's how we run our everyday purchases. I know I think about it when I'm buying a car,
sure,
how much I'm going to have to pay on maintenance.
Or buying a house.
Exactly. So I think it's just a matter of teaching and making positive decisions, or giving them the tools to make these types of decisions so that they can actually make an educated determination of how much money am I going to output for the next 30 years, and also how much money am I going to save if I pick one of these various options. And then, of course, we always teach in the actual contract management stage, you have to go back and verify that your assumptions on your life cycle cost analysis, that it was correct. Otherwise, don't use that one anymore because you were off. You know, obviously, it's a learning experience. You're teaching them how to use this type of information. And information is power when you're building infrastructure. And you're basically educating them on how to make smarter investments.
So does it require a significant leap in either human resource quality or human resource training to be trained up to make these sort of sophisticated analyses?
It depends.
Yeah,
and the message we try to get across is you need to think about this in terms of the purchaser. What makes sense here? You can be buying, to use the example I always use in class, laser printers or desktop printers. Desktop printers, you should be thinking about life cycle costs, because often the ink cartridges, right, completely distort the price competition for the original desktop printer. Right? Same thing true for cell phones. When you're buying a cell phone, the plan that you're going to be spending on, there are other things about the cell phone that may want to drive your price decision at the beginning. So there's not a one-size-fits-all. It needs to be tailored. And if what you're buying is a power plant, you need to be talking, you, the government procurement person, need to be talking and listening both to industry and to government people who are experts in power plants. Procurement people are not experts in everything they're buying. That's not their job. Their job is to reach out to the experts and learn and listen.
So, Marianne, would GE prefer to have a whole cohort of procurement officers around the world that have a set of tools that not just low bid, that actually are capable of actually making discernments about purchases based on life cycle cost or other? Talk a little bit about how does GE look at things like life cycle cost? Is that a preferred approach for GE?
Generally speaking, we're not going to be the cheapest. If you're just doing low bid, low cost, we are a world-class technology innovator. We bring a lot more than we don't like to just be looked at for cost. There's all kinds of other quality considerations and the life cycle, the efficiencies and all of that that are important. So yes, we would prefer that there are other tools, evaluation criteria that are more sophisticated and nuanced than just who has the cheapest initial bid in what they're offering. That's important.
So it seems to me that there's some need for capacity building and training, and some of that's being met by GPI, thankfully. Seems like there's perhaps an unlimited demand for this, and there's sort of limited resources. So talk a little bit about where are we going to get there. I mean, it seems like, it seems as if just either because of modernity, because of demands for energy or infrastructure, we're going to need a lot more capable public administrators around the world, and so there's going to be a demand to pay for all this. Where are we going to find the money for this?
Shall I say a couple of words?
Yeah, please.
A couple of things. Number one, one of the important first steps is having a legal framework that lets you focus on something other than low price. One of the frustrations in some countries, India is one, but there are many countries that face this.
You said something like 6 million people in India touched the procurement process in India?
Right, that could well be. But what I was going to say was that the law requires going to low price. And that's true in many countries. Yeah. Fixing that is very important. I think the World Bank's initiative to allow World Bank finance projects to go not on low price, but on a price quality ratio is a big step forward. The legal reform is very important. The training, as you say, is almost an endless challenge. But we got to be fair. That's true in the United States, too. Training, I worried about it all the time as administrator. It's an enormous challenge. I think that what USTDA does is an important contribution to that.
I agree with that.
It's also true that other organizations are helping, both in the U.S. government and outside. The World Bank, for example, is very focused on online training. That could be enormously helpful going forward. There are possibilities of improving training so you get more outreach.
Could we just spend 1 minute more on just the World Bank policy that's coming out and why is that important? Because I know there are many people in the audience that are following that issue. Either Andrea, do you want to?
Actually, I think Dan is. He was actually a part of the team that looked at a lot of the reform efforts.
I was honored to be on the advisory group of the World Bank. I think the World Bank has modernized. It's already in effect now. They've modernized their procurement policy. They're looking for more flexibility in their procurement policy. For example, they're much more welcoming to the idea of framework agreements, what the Americans call IDIQs. But they're also more welcoming and open to the idea of using the procurement systems in borrowing countries when they meet the standards. That are the international standards. They're more open, for this discussion particularly important, they're more open to the idea of not going to the lowest evaluated price, but instead looking at price and quality. So I think the World Bank has taken a good step forward.
My sense is, and just correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems as if the World Bank has been sort of the standard, the toolkit that the World Bank has offered governments has operated on sort of two levels. One has been, if you're going to take my World Bank money, you're going to use my World Bank rule set for making buying decisions. That was issue one. But there was a second implied component to it where the World Bank was, in essence, exporting a specific standard worldwide, and people said, okay, you're the World Bank, we trust you, I'm just going to take that off the shelf, and I'm going to use that as for everything else, because we were talking about this earlier, Marianne, I think it's global purchasing decisions through public procurements, only a very small percentage of that, whether it's infrastructure, energy, actually are touched by MDB money. It's some other source of money. So the importance of this reform isn't just the large dollar amounts, but even still a small percentage of all the global infrastructure or other sorts of government procurements that are touched by the MDBs, but it's also the fact that they are a global standard setter for government procurement agencies.
Yeah.
So I guess one of the things, as they make this change, and I think it's the first one in 30 or 40 or maybe 50 years.
Yeah.
So it's sort of like the way I've understood it is to think about moving from a VCR standard to a DVD standard of procurement. That was sort of the best I could come up with in terms of simplifying this. But I guess the question I've wondered is in addition to governments, will governments adopt the DVD standard? How much, certainly there's a number of middle-income countries that TDA works with. I see you guys as sort of the development agency for middle and upper middle-income countries. That's not how you see yourselves, but that's when I think about you guys. I think about, as you move up the development curve, you want access to higher quality government and higher quality products and et cetera. So I wouldn't be surprised if many of those countries actually do adopt the DVD standard. But do you think, maybe you can just answer,
right.
Do you think there is an appetite for government to say, oh, I'm so glad you reformed. In addition to when I take your money, I'm gonna copy paste and take this new standard and I'm gonna apply it across my government system.
Yes and no. The core message I would say is this. The World Bank's revised procurement policy is remarkably consistent with the other messages out there. There was a time not many years ago when people in developing countries would say, they're driving me crazy. Everybody we deal with is giving us different rules, different approaches. Mm. It's extraordinary the consistency today between the message from USTDA, the message from the World Bank, the message from UNCTRA, the UN Commission on International Trade Law, the message from the WTO Agreement on Government Procurement, the EU. There is a developing consensus on the best way to run procurements that I think is encouraging, and it is getting countries' attention. So there's been procurement reform consistent with that better message. For example, in Armenia recently, I could list the countries where there's been procurement reform in countries that are not wealthy, sophisticated procurement countries, and yet those international standards and that international message is getting through and is being adopted.
Is that standard based on an American set of standards?
No. It is an international standard. There are many things that are similar to the U.S. system. There are other things that aren't.
Okay. Did you want to add something?
No, I think...
When is the policy coming out, though, for the World Bank?
It's already out.
It's out. Okay.
It was approved by the board in July.
Right, in July. Okay.
But I believe a lot of the details are still to come, right?
Absolutely.
A lot of the procedural things, mm-hmm. It's sort of like the devil's in the details. If you're asked how much you like it, it depends how the details shake out. But overall, I think it's a great direction.
The policy itself has been developed, and it is live as of July. However, they're still working on the implementation. And there's a lot of tools in that box that they've created, and we were very pleased to see that the value for money was taken into consideration. And they did a lot of good work to make sure that they could utilize a model for value for money. And they've also allowed countries to say, you can apply if your standards are high enough, you can use your standards. And so a lot of the countries that are already working with us through the GPI, they're taking that little opening and saying, fine, I'm going to take my value for money and my higher quality standards, and I'm going to see how we can implement this here. And if it's good enough and transparent enough, the World Bank will accept it and let me use my own procurement law.
So let me take a couple of questions. Okay. My friend there and my friend here, these two folks. So
microphone on its way.
Yeah. Name, rank, and serial number, please. Keep it short.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jim Waller from Nathan Associates. I'm a procurement fan, so you can count me in that
wow.
box there. And Dan,
long walks in the park, candlelight dinners,
breathe
and
deeply, right?
You know, value-based procurement on the weekends. Right.
Right. This panel is a great compliment to the other workshops you've had on corruption and domestic resource mobilization. This is another side of the coin. First question, well, I have just three very quick questions. One, metrics. How do you measure how your training program is successful? By people trained or actual results? The IMF has developed a public investment management assessment tool, and globally they say you can get 30% more bang for the buck for procurement in developing countries. Do you use such big metrics, you know, overall, or do you look just at people trained? Second, in terms of publicity, it seems to me procurement should be a key point of achieving the sustainable development goals. But my quick read of 169 targets is that procurement's not in there. DRM is in there.
Well, that's pretty bad. If everything else got in there, everyone brought their pet rocks to that thing, so
but
good
I mean,
luck.
But clearly, I mean, if education, health, infrastructure is all part of the goals, procurement should figure in there some way, and I think that maybe CSIS could give that some profile. And finally, in terms of, you know, leading by example, the United States at one time, I think, had lowest cost technically acceptable as a procurement kind of rule because of budget restrictions, and Defense Department is quite keen on this. How do you respond to countries saying, look, we have tight budgets too, why don't we go to lowest cost technically acceptable like the United States is doing? Thanks.
Okay. My friend over here. Did I see Jeffrey Marbury?
Good afternoon. My name is Rosemary Seguero. I'm Seguero's International Group. Thank you so much for your presentation. My comment is to Anne. Looking at career path and changing mindset, how do you, looking at the United States is I don't know how the projects and things are more sustainable than China. But if you look at China, looking at India, they are more corrupt, and then you put on Africa, three big corruption. So how do you deal with such a situation, looking at procurement, especially working in Africa, and now coming up with your initiative, which is great? How do you deal with that, India, with China, corruption, and then Africa? Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, let me just get Jeffrey Marburg Goodman, my friend from Creative Associates.
Well, you can give me my name, rank, and serial number. Very quickly, for those of us who have been doing this kind of training for many years, this is the GPI is a wonderful initiative. Love to see this initiative. And you could see that, you know, I'm obviously a procurement guy, pretty drably dressed, though I took off my tie. The question is, what, and this also may be an answer to what both Dan's talk about, is the infinite need. What effort is being made to marry up GPI with the needs of the U.S. Development Program and trade program? When we do these, and I've worked on many of these trade agreements, there is that procurement chapter, and there was behind it, USAID did this,
things like an trade effort capacity, to do capacity building. Part of the trade capacity
and if you think about MCC and what it does, and if you think about the local solutions effort at USAID, you could marry up the procurement needs in those countries to sort of prioritize, it seems to me. I'm wondering if any of that's being done.
Thank you. That's great. I actually would agree that so things like local solutions, trade agreements, so local solutions is, you know, the whole responding to the Paris, Accra, Busan global partnership agenda. That's a word. It's not, but it seems like one more. But there's been this whole issue around country ownership and country systems. If you actually want to have country ownership and country systems, this is absolutely, if you're at AID and you're responding to that, or you're the State Department, then you ought to be calling, you ought to have Andrea Lupo on your speed dial, right? Right. Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so there's several really interesting questions here. I'm going to let you all just respond to each, any and all.
Sure. I'll start with you in terms of indicators and how we measure our impact. That's a really good question, because as we start out, there are differing organizations that have differing ways of measuring impact. One of which we looked at was the OECD. They developed a MAPS tool. It's called the Method for Assessing Procurement Systems in Various Countries. It has a lot of the indicators that we want to be able to use, and we reached out to the OECD as one of our initial partners to see if they would be willing to work with us on measuring our impact. The problem is the MAPS tool is a self-assessment for countries to self-assess. And as you know, we've read some of those assessments, and it seems like some folks were a little generous in their assessment of their procurement systems. So what we are doing as we go through...
So everybody
through,
got an A? And a trophy, right.
So what we're doing, of course we're measuring and counting the number of people that we're trained, but what you also need to know is that we are also videotaping every training and leaving it behind so that they can train other staff members, because obviously we can't train the entire procurement workforce in any one country. We're leaving that along. We're trying to leave and build capacity within, help them, put them on the professionalization path, and then we are measuring and working with them. That's why we call it a partnership. Rather than just giving a grant, they become a partner with us. The agreement says that they agree to partner with us for 5 years, and we're working off of these couple of areas. And so they are helping report back to us. So what I gave you earlier was from a report that we received from Botswana, which is great, where they're telling me all of the changes that they're making in their government as a result of it. And they're also coming back to me saying, you know what, we need a little bit more support in these couple of areas. Can you send us an expert that can talk about how we develop a code of ethics, or because we realize we're missing that and we need that to support our procurement system. So we're utilizing indicators from a lot of our organization and a lot of our partners. We're working with the World Bank, because a lot of them and the IDB and the MDBs, they have these baseline reports for the procurement system. But we're also, like I said, working very directly with the governments on where they see the improvements and what changes that they're making. Oh, sorry.
Andrea, I'm just going to jump in. I think the other thing, the way that we measure it because of our mission is to try to ensure that U.S. businesses have fair opportunities. It's exactly that. I mean, Botswana was a very good example where, as a result of what they did, subsequently more U.S. businesses bid on future procurements, more U.S. businesses were shortlisted. So we go all the way to the ultimate results of leveling the playing field, not just the training.
Absolutely. So we are monitoring the tenders. Of course, our advisors, let me just be clear, are not involved in the selection process. They are helping design the tenders and everything, but to avoid any conflict of interest. They're not involved in the selection, but they help them create the systems and the evaluation processes so that they can guide them through the process. But we will be monitoring it to see the outcome, because ultimately what we care about is the outcome.
Yeah. Marion.
I wanted to just mention the question about the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, and that there is not an overt, addressing of procurement. Perhaps it's a miss, but perhaps some very creative policymakers could weave into the other indicators, the other goals, whether they're dealing with infrastructure or health, all the different things that are there. There could be like a sub bullet. I don't know.
We're gonna have Amina Mohammed here off the record next week, so I'll raise that with her over lunch.
And then on that note, I do believe there are other tools or openings for additional focus on procurement through such things like the U.S. government has with bilaterally with countries. I know there's this new thing coming out of the Commerce Department, a new initiative for MOUs on infrastructure development. There's one with Kenya. There's a recently signed MOU. In that, there could be room for, as you're developing infrastructure and U.S. companies are focusing more, there could be an element of procurement reform in there. There's also this new President's Advisory Council on Doing Business in Africa with a very interesting acronym, something like PACDB, I can't even say it. There could be an opportunity within that to weave in some pretty robust procurement, unless you're already doing that. But I think that there are these, procurement's not exciting, so it gets left out.
I thought we made it exciting over this hour.
It just takes, I think, repeated voices.
Yes.
Hammering it as a key
I agree with that.
Thing.
And I think,
Andrea.
I think just partnering off of what you said, and then of course getting to your question in terms of how do we marry that up within the U.S. government, we are working with many of our partners, including the MCC, including USAID. Everywhere we go, we make sure that that the U.S. government is speaking with one voice. USTDA is of course pushing the value for money piece, and we're working with MCC and others on how they can improve their own procurement processes to make sure that they are incorporating value for money, because obviously we don't want to be not practicing what we're preaching through the GPI. And so we actually work across the U.S. government. Every country that we go into, we make sure that AID, MCC, we're all working in the same direction. And we're also doing a lot of work here just kind of on the policy side on how do we help them, implement some of the own things that we're teaching, using LCCA and things of that nature. So I appreciate the question, because I know we realize it's helpful to speak with one voice and push everyone in the same direction, and that's what we are trying to do.
Dan.
30 seconds, because I'm very sensitive to everyone's time. But the question about corruption is so important. Let me say that what the audiences always hear from me is that balance of those tugs. Yes, you want to be focused on quality. Yes, you want to be flexible. But yes, you need to have transparency. You need to have accountability, because the risk of corruption is real. And not only in India and China. I come from the great state of Maryland, Annapolis, Maryland, which has a rich history of corruption in procurement. Believe me, everybody needs that transparency and that accountability that balances, all right, the flexibility and the focus on quality. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to be here afterwards. Okay. If people want to talk more with me, I'll be happy to.
So Lee, come up here and just give us your final thoughts about this after listening to this discussion. There are very few people who can make procurement interesting. You've made procurement interesting for me, and these panelists have made procurement interesting for me. But I think the stakes are really quite high and quite important, and I think the fact that so many folks have stayed and showed up for this, I think speaks to the fact that they understand that the stakes are high.
Well, thanks very much, Dan. And first of all, I want to thank you. And I think one of the things that this panel did is convince Dan that procurement is important. Mm. So if we could give them a round of applause.
Yes.
And a couple things that I think we heard throughout the panel was, one, that there are conflicting interests and why this is important. It's important to economic development. It's important because of the focus on corruption. And it's important because host countries are focusing on their local SMEs and that these are in conflict, but this is an area that is going to be addressing these and one that is going to be very important to what it is that they're focused on. What's new? One of the things I heard that was very interesting was this focus on professionalization of procurement officers around the world and creating a safe environment where procurement officers can talk about how they go forward with their practices. And I think that's an incredibly valuable part of what everyone is talking about here today. The other thing, of course, that came up that's near and dear to my heart is the fact that there are results from this. The results with respect to training, but results with respect to what people get in the end for what they are procuring. And hearing from GE and others about the fact that they're going to look at the procurement system to determine whether or not that they're going to bid. So I think what this brings us to as we're closing today is that it's the procurement is not something that we think about, but it's something we do every day. And when we make our own decisions, we often look to see sort of what the best value is, what the quality is of what we're doing. And this is something in particular on large ticket items is really important to do, especially for developing middle-income countries, because they're developing the future of their people. So I want to thank everyone here today for their contributions. Thank you for everything that we've learned. And thank you for making procurement exciting.